next what we're going to do is we're going to go into our liquid granite and our liquid terrazzo system. This is going to be known as a paint chip floor system, really commonly utilized in garages, but could also be used in other areas, multi-purpose rooms, hangars. You see the decorative kitchen sometimes utilizing the chip flakes. Sometimes can be utilized in an exterior application, but I'll speak to that a little bit because there are some different components needed to support that function. But basically what you have with the liquid granite is you have this type of an effect. Really nice chip broadcast floor. This is a really, really nice way to do most residential commercial garages. It's going to work really, really well. And it's probably the most commonly specified or utilized system in that type of environment. Okay. So what this starts with is, and I'll show you guys a process sample here for reference. We get questions on sometimes what's the difference between liquid granite and liquid terrazzo. It's really simple. It's basically just the coverage rate or broadcast rate of your chips. So for example, if you can see that, liquid granite here is a full coverage or 100% broadcast to refusal of our TC60 color chips. Whereas this liquid terrazzo, you can see that we've done a partial broadcast of our chips, okay? So you're seeing some of the negative space or the body coat or the broadcast coat there underneath of our EC34. That's really the main difference. Aesthetically, again, just a little bit more of the body coat shining through, so a little more reliance on that. Whereas you might have a little bit of textural differences. The liquid terrazzo will typically exhibit a little bit more smoother of a finish, so maybe a little better cleanability. On the flip side, the liquid terrazzo will typically provide you with a little bit better inherent non-skid and slip resistance. So this might be more ideal for some users who are looking for a little bit more texture. Of course, you can always put more top coats or additional top coats and utilize various materials for that. So we're gonna jump right into the system. I'm not going to spend too much time kind of reiterating surface prep, inspection, moisture in these elements because we've already spoke to those and Mallory had that great presentation to kind of recap that. But please be sure to refer back to the specifications on those steps. So in this instance, we're actually going to go ahead and show you the application of our EC15 MVB or our moisture vapor barrier. So let's again remind ourselves of why we were choosing to elect this. So if we were exceeding 5 pounds or 75% RH, we're going to utilize this EC15 material. The EC15 is available in a 1.65 gallon kit or a 4.125 gallon kit, a larger kit for yield. So with the EC15, again, if our levels exceed what's recommended in there, we're gonna elect to use the EC15 to properly help and combat moisture vapor emission rates, okay? So one thing to note is when we're talking about EC12 and these systems, we're in approximately CSP 2 to 3. When we utilize a moisture vapor barrier, we really need to ensure that we have proper adhesion, really good soak-in, and an increase of our surface profile. So instead of being at CSP 2 to 3, we're going to now go up to CSP 3 to 4. So now we're looking at typically a shot blast or a very aggressive mechanical profile that's possibly created by diamond grinding, but utilizing usually like a bushing hammer, pulverizer, some type of attachment like that that can help get you into that coarser, higher profile of CSP. So do be careful of that and start with that, because if you stick with a CSP of 1 or 2, you're really not creating enough tooth or profile for this higher build MVB to properly bond and attach. And again, most common reasons that we see coating failures, lack of surface prep and moisture related issues. So for the EC15, again, it's a 1.65 and a 4.125 gallon kit. It does not have a 2-to-1 ratio. So be mindful of that and do not break the kits. Because you don't have this straight 2-to-1 ratio, you're not going to have the ease of just doing a volumetric viewpoint and just pouring these out by eyesight. You really need to make sure that you're mixing all of your part A and all of your part B together to ensure that you have a proper mix design because of that unique stoichiometry or stoich. Okay, so what we're going to do now is we're going to pan over to Mike Pittman, and he's going to show you the mixing application of our EC15. Now, as we talked about before, he's got his stopwatch ready on his phone. He's pouring in his part B. He's ensuring that he's not pouring the material onto the sidewalls of the mixing vessel so that it's not properly going to be mixed in. He's then going to add his part A. He's utilizing spatulas and other tools to potentially get any excessive material that might be left in the can so that we get all of the content, so all of the A and the B are fully digesting and cross-linking and becoming one. Again, with the EC15, this is a very, very, very pure epoxy, free of any diluents, any other fillers, to get you extremely tight cross-linking. This gives you excellent chemical resistance, but more importantly, this gives you amazing moisture tolerance and acts as a really amazing MVB, okay? This is really crucial here, and when we're trying to combat levels that are exceeding that 5 pounds or 75% RH. So Mike's gonna go ahead and mix all this. He's getting out all the contents of the can, again, ensuring that he gets a full proper balance of the A and the B materials. And then just like before, he's gonna mix these thoroughly for 3 to 5 minutes with a mechanical drill with low RPM. Now for this step, we do not recommend any thinners typically be used. We would say that you would apply this material neat. Now in certain instances where we have issues of very, very challenging substrates, please refer to the EC15 product specification sheet for more details, because there is a recommended two-step program that can be used when you have a really, really troubled surface or substrate that might have issues. In that case, we do recommend then a thin coat followed by a neat coat. But for most typical applications that are within the restrictions or limitations of the MVB, you're going to apply this material neat, and we're applying this material at approximately 80 to 100 square feet per gallon. This will net a minimum of 16 mils. And that's crucial that we get those adequate mils during the application so that we have this shield, or essentially this barrier, acting to protect against the moisture vapor barrier or the moisture vapor emission. So as you can see, Mike's thoroughly mixing the product, ensuring that he's mixing the sides, getting all of the A and the B to digest and cross-link and become one. Again, mixing is so crucial in our industry to ensure that we get a proper, proper product. So once that material is completely mixed, we are going to be demonstrating this material with the proper application methods. Because we're applying this at 80 to 100 square feet per gallon versus our typical rate of 250 to 300 on the EC12, it's crucial that Mike puts this down with the proper methodology. So again, we've said that our substrate is prepared to a CSP 3 or 4. Mike's gonna go ahead and now put down the material, and he's gonna utilize a notch trowel set with the appropriate mils, as I mentioned earlier. So go ahead, Mike, and we can put that down. So you can see he's pouring out a bead. He's taking his notch squeegee, and he's applying this at the appropriate mil thickness to ensure that we have even mil thickness across the floor. If you are ever in doubt of your mil thickness, the best way to check is you can do square footage coverage, but you wanna utilize a wet mil gauge, okay? So now what we can do is we can look at the wet mil gauge, and for those that may not be as familiar, a wet mil gauge is basically a helpful indication of wet mils by placing the gauge into the wet film, and you can see where it correlates to what number on your wet mil gauge. Now we have these free of charge. If you ever want this little helpful tool, I always keep a few in my truck. If I'm ever inspecting a job, I wanna look and put this in the floor. So for example, I've gone ahead, I've determined we need about 16 mils. I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna place that onto the surface. And we've hit right onto the 16 mils. So we're perfect there. So that's really, really helpful. I'm gonna go ahead and wipe this because I usually get epoxy all over myself. And again, just a great helpful reference there to ensure that we're getting all the proper, oh, thank you. Awesome. Wipe that off so I don't trace epoxy all throughout the facility. And again, after I wipe this off, I can reutilize this tool and keep using it over and over and over. But this is a great way to tell. Obviously, you can put spike marks or tape marks on the wall to ensure that you're kind of visually getting a certain coverage rate based on the square footage of the space. But you do want to ensure that when you're doing this application, you might have highs and lows. You might have irregularities in your surface preparation. So when you are doing your mill thickness measurements, ensure that you do multiple spots, okay? Because you might be just, for example, getting on the high parts of the texture of the concrete, and you might not actually truly be getting 16 mils. Again, that 16 mils should be on the top of the highest point, not in the low spot of the texture. That's not going to be a full 16 mils or 80 to 100 square feet yields, providing you with the adequate protection that is needed to combat those moisture issues. So Mike's gone ahead and notched that out. He's gone ahead and back rolled to ensure complete coverage. And essentially, we're good and we're ready to go with our EC15. Again, this material is available only in this kind of clear amber color. And again, comes in a 1.65 or a 4.125 gallon unit, available upon request. Just let us know. We stock this material. And again, this is going to be when your moisture levels are exceeding the 5 pounds or 75% RH. So after we've applied that material, that would typically dry. Again, you're approximately at your, 4 to 8 hours on this. It's a little bit faster drying material, which will help speed up your dry times, get you faster on it. We do get questions. Sometimes people ask, can I use the MVB with other systems outside of your resinous EC category? Yes, you can. You can utilize the EC15, for example, with use of our matte coat system on concrete when needed. You can also utilize it with our texturecrete systems or our cementitious overlays when you are utilizing or when you need that moisture vapor barrier to help protect. In those applications, you're typically going to put down the MVB neat, then come back with a coat of EC12, broadcast sand till refusal, and now you've got a nice profile to help anchor your cementitious topping, okay? So next, what we're gonna do is we're gonna show you the application of our broadcast coat or our body coat to receive the broadcast. So again, we would use EC12 or EC15 as needed for our primer, just as mentioned, you saw in the thin film. And next, we're gonna show you the application of the EC34, okay? So we're gonna go ahead and pass this over to Mike. You can watch him mix the EC34 again. Now, just like we saw in the first application, all the same practices are gonna be there, mixing a 2-to-1 ratio of the EC34, 3 to 5 minutes, making sure that we properly mix that material. Again, this is gonna be available in a 1.5 gallon, 15 gallon, and we also have drums available of this product as well. Pigmented materials available to hide. And for the EC34, we're going to be putting down this product, about approximately 175 to 225 square feet to help over the primer coat to now receive our chips. Now, as Mike's mixing that, I do wanna provide you guys with some other resources available. So if you can see, we have a color chart here that references our chips, our blends. This is our TC60. So we have a variety of blends here available for all of these. You can see that. These are standard pre-blended mixes of these colors, all of it ready available. We also have a really nice epoxy brochure here. This is for industrial coatings. All of our systems are featured in here. And it's a really nice trifold that illustrates a lot of our systems, descriptions, and gives you a great idea of the system offerings that we have at Westcoat. All of that literature is free. You just let us know. You can contact us at westcoat.com or reach out to us directly via our phone, and we can help you out with that. I showed you guys the process samples earlier. Those are available tools that you can see right there. We also have our 3x3 cured swatches available, if you can see these. All of our blends are ready and sealed with these. They're all labeled. So if you need any sales tools or props, these are really, really handy to give to customers, architects, specifiers, to provide them with an idea of what the finish are. We also indicate the desired top coat and sheen and finish over these samples. And again, all are labeled accordingly on the back so you can find all that information, okay? Again, if you need any of these tools or resources, please just contact us directly, and we're happy to send these out to you guys, UPS, and we get them those out. Also, be sure to reach out to your distributor. They might already have these in stock and can help you out as well, okay? So Mike's gone ahead and thoroughly mixed that product. So now what we're going to do is we're going to apply that material, and then we're going to go ahead and proceed with our broadcast of our chips. So the first thing Mike's going to do is he's going to pour it onto the substrate. Again, typically we'd be squeegeeing and back rolling. For this application, we're just going to kind of dip and roll with the squeegee because we're only on, you know, 4x4 board here. So he's pouring out his material. Again, always maintaining a wet edge. If we were in a garage facility that has joints, expansion joints, we're going to honor those joints to ensure that we're not burying the material, coating the sidewalls of the joints, brushing it out so that it's not flooding, and again, honoring those joints. So Mike's going to go ahead and roll this material out. Again, we're looking for probably a yield of approximately 175 to 225 square feet on the EC34. And again, we're coating over our EC15 that had been previously dried from the day before. Now, we sometimes get questions about fisheye, contaminants, and these types of other things. Sometimes that can be attributed to either surface contaminants. It can sometimes be attributed to going past the recoat window. So do be kind of mindful of this. If you are seeing issues regarding contaminants, maybe it was oil contamination, silicone, or other types of things, there are ways to treat that, okay? If you have other questions on that more specifically, reach out to us directly and we can kind of talk to you. It's a little bit more longer of a conversation, but generally you can also see crawling or fisheye effects associated with going past the recoat window. And again, that's important. You might also see sometimes off-gassing that can occur, especially if you have higher moisture levels in your slab or if installing first thing in the morning. And that can sometimes relate to kind of these volcanoes or pinholing from the off-gassing effect of the epoxy related to moisture vapor emissions. Okay. So Mike's gone ahead and applied the EC34 top coat here per spec. You can see that we've got a nice even coverage, good opacity and hide. Okay. Next, what we're going to have him do is broadcast our TC60 chips. This particular blend is called sandstone in a complementary color. So anytime you want to utilize a certain color of chips, you want to use a complementary color because there might be a little negative space or a little bit of information in the epoxy coat left over. So as you can see, Mike, you want to show them that bucket? I don't know if you can read it very well. You can kind of see here. Let me grab it over and put in the camera. Thanks, Mike. So you can see kind of the blend is a nice kind of color. We'll see if the color picks it up. There you go. And you can kind of see it's a nice complementary blend. So again, you're avoiding using like a black and a tan, a blue and an orange, or some crazy color. Now, there are customers that want those things, and that is available upon request, so you just let us know. But generally speaking, you'd want to refer to our specification sheet. We actually give you a recommended color choice that corresponds with your TC60. So hand that back over to Mike. And we're going to first start off by showing you the terrazzo look. Now the terrazzo look, this liquid terrazzo look, is basically a partial broadcast. Now that could be anywhere from 5% coverage to 70% coverage, but Mike's going to go ahead and demonstrate a partial coverage or terrazzo on part of the board, showing you just a light coverage of the TC60 chips. Now, one thing you'll notice is the methodology in which he's doing this. You want to be consistent and even so that you're doing this across the whole floor. It's actually more difficult to do this than it is to do the full broadcast. Because you can imagine the other one, you're broadcasting till refusal. Very, very simple. But to actually maintain this look consistently over, say, you know, 5,000, 10,000 square feet can be kind of challenging. Now, the benefits of it, though, will be that you'll have extended yields of your top coat. You're utilizing less chip. And then, of course, you're getting this nice kind of balance between the epoxy coat and the chip coat. So you can see he's done a nice partial broadcast here, fairly even. We're not going to flip this board for demonstration purposes right now because that would be kind of detrimental to the finish and the chips. But now, now he's got some stylish effects going on here. So now he's going to show you broadcasting till refusal, all right? And this is essentially what the name sounds, basically beaching or a full broadcast, 100% coverage, ensuring no shiners, no holidays, 100% coverage of our TC60 color chips. Now, this is really important that you do this so that it's consistent, even, and that you have 100% coverage and no holidays that would either potentially cause a negative effect visually or aesthetically or texturally. So perfect. So Mike's gone ahead and basically covered that board completely. We will have a little bit of excessive chips. Often if you have a fairly clean environment, those chips can be collected. And if they're not pulverized or damaged, in some cases actually can be reutilized for other jobs, especially if you're obviously selling the same color, of course. Some applicators will choose to maybe focus on 2 to 3 colors and just utilize those, sometimes repurposing some of the chips. Again, if they're sterile, you know, free of other debris contaminants, in some cases you can reutilize those for a couple projects by, you know, after this is dried for approximately 6 to 8 hours, cleaning up the excessive chips and then reapplying. Okay. We did have a question coming in about the need to cleaning mix paddles or mixing blades between mixes. Great question. Yes, you would always want to ensure that you're cleaning your tools before or in between mixes, especially if this is going to be different products. But it's really crucial if you're even using the same product, because you might have some curing material or material that is kicking on the mixing blade that you might introduce into your next batch. So as you're mixing batch over batch over batch, if you don't properly clean these mixing vessels, you might get some activated epoxy from your first batch into your second batch, or your third batch, or fourth batch, so forth. And what that might affect is potentially your pot life or working time. Again, we're working with 100% solids epoxies here, so you do have limited pot life. You know, it's not quite as much working time as, say, a water-based material. So be mindful and conscious of that. Now, in a mass, the epoxies are going to generate more heat. They're going to kick off. So we'll get this call once a month. Hey, it's smoking in the bucket. And generally that's the applicator was not paying attention to the pot life with this. So now they were just walking around, maybe coating the stem wall, taking their sweet time, and it got away from them. Be very, very conscious. We do everything we can to engineer these products to give you the best pot lives, but they're just basic limitations to the materials, okay? So once you get the material onto the floor, you have much more working time with these epoxies because they're not generating that heat and mass and cooking off, okay? So that concludes the broadcast portion of this. The guys are gonna go ahead and they're gonna break these boards off stage, and we're gonna bring in the other board ready to receive our top coat. So there's a question that came in about when you're applying this material. This could be regardless of thin film, liquid granite, liquid dazzle. Well, what do you do? Okay, how do you get out on these floors? So there are dedicated cleats or spike shoes that are available at specialty supply stores that can help you get into this wet material so that you're not, you know, basically having full surface contact of your shoes, only the minimal contact from the spikes to walk in this wet fluid material. Be conscious though that you still need to consider what your pot lives and your dry times are, because if you get too far into this product, your spike marks may not heal. So there is a window of when that's appropriate. Now, additionally, you're typically gonna have, you know, a team of applicators supporting you. So you might be in the wet material, but you don't wanna walk into the broadcasting material with your spikes. You want to work your way out. Okay, so I hope that helps. And we always learn from our mistakes. I hope this demo is helping to reduce some of those mistakes, but the reality is we're always gonna have these things that occur. And the big thing is that we learn from them and don't repeat them. But I've been doing this for 11 years. Mike's been doing this for, I think, 27 years. So we've seen and done things, and we've learned a lot from those. That's why we try and also indicate proper notes into our specifications, into our training videos, to try and help, you know, reduce the chance of these things occurring on the job site. Okay, so next what we have is we have this board that has been broadcasted and received the TC60 chips, full coverage. At this point, we would do a few things. Mike, what would we do after we've poured this? We would typically scrape and vacuum, correct? Okay, so Mike's gonna go ahead and demonstrate that. Now, there's a variety of tools that can be used. For demonstration purposes here, Mike's gonna use, you know, just a regular drywall knife. But you could utilize a few things. Typically, what you're going to utilize on a large scale would be this type of floor scraper, okay? Now, a couple things to be mindful of. You do not want to excessively gouge the floor because some of these chips may be soft. You want to use even pressure, light pressure, and just enough of an angle to take these down. This is an important aspect to fully scrape these floors because you might have chips that fall vertically, which then potentially after you're coated will become very sharp and aggressive. And if Mrs. Jones, Mr. Smith are walking barefoot in their garage, they're not going to find that pleasant. You're going to get a callback, okay? So taking the time to detail after your chip application will really help not only to provide you a little bit better yield on your epoxy top coat, but also to flatten these out, get yourself a nice even texture, and really make the customer happy with the finish, okay? So Mike's gone ahead and scraped. Perfect. So he's removed all the loose chips, any of the chips that might have been in more of a vertical orientation. And now we're going to have a nice planed out surface to receive our top coat. So now we're going to go ahead and talk about the top coat that's recommended for the liquid granite or liquid terrazzo systems. So again, we mentioned EC12 primer, EC15 if you need for the extended moisture vapor barrier, EC34, our epoxy top coat that was also used for the thin film, can be used here to chip into. And now we're ready for our top coat, okay? The standard top coat in the system is the EC32 clear epoxy top coat. Now you can also utilize EC101 or EC102. We're gonna go ahead and pass this over to Mike. You can watch him mixing the EC32 and I'll kind of expand on some points. So the EC32 clear epoxy top coat is a clear material as indicated. It is not available in pigmented. It's a dedicated workhorse epoxy. This 32 is used as our clear top coat in this system as well as other systems. The EC32 is also commonly used to hold aggregates, for example, in an epoxy mortar system. You could utilize the EC32 in a double broadcast system, for example, like our Dubro quartz, where you apply EC32 and you broadcast TC65 quartz sand. But it's a really, really versatile product. We see this EC32 used over our texture-crete interior systems. It's also sometimes utilized for other just clear coats in grind and seal applications, or anywhere where you need 100% solids, high build, clear epoxy top coat. So Mike has gone ahead and mixed 2-to-1. All the best practices of mixing are still being employed. He's got his stopwatch. He stopped and put his PPE on. Thank you, Mike. Now, this product is available in 1.5 gallon, 15 gallon, and drum kits. For the top coat, we're typically going to be looking at a yield of approximately 200 to 300 square feet per gallon. Now, that coverage can vary based on the overall texture and finish desired in the system. Again, remember, you can utilize a polyaspartic material. And earlier I had mentioned that there might be applications where you have UV exposure concerns, or you might have areas where maybe there's partial UV exposure. So let's say we're in a garage and there's the apron of the garage right here and we're getting south-facing sun that's coming in. Well, the regular EC32, EC34 materials might be more subjective, more commonly known to amber with time, especially depending on how much UV exposure. If you're ever faced with that project where you know you're gonna have UV exposure, you're best not to utilize the epoxies, and you wanna look at our polyaspartic line. That's gonna be the EC1 or EC102. You would prime with EC12 or EC15 as mentioned. You could apply EC101 or EC102 for your body coat to broadcast into, chip into that. The acrylic chips are fine, they're UV stable themselves. And then utilize the EC101 or EC102 as your final top coat. That would give you a UV stable finish so that if you're doing this outside, for example, some customers do have that desire, or you just know that there's gonna be UV exposure, whether it be big windows, whether it be roll-up doors, whether it's maybe a garage where they're gonna be having it always up on display, whatever it may be, look to elect the UV stable options, such as, again, the EC102. So now Mike's gone ahead and activated that product. He's gonna bring it over to the board. Now, in this application, we would typically be utilizing a squeegee. For example, you know, like this large squeegee. He's going to apply this material. Now, on this small scale, he's going to utilize a rubber float to kind of help gauge the coverage rate of the EC32. This is going to help avoid thicker applications and thinner applications. This is going to ensure more proper mill thickness across as the rubber float, or, and again, in a project, a squeegee would be used to help gauge the material evenly. Also gives you faster production speed. So you can see Mike's working the material back and forth. Obviously, you'd have a team of applicators on large scale projects. Do be mindful if you are working with squeegees or other materials. Sometimes these squeegees will wear down, whether it be a notch squeegee or a flat blade squeegee. So you want to kind of keep up on your tools and make sure that you're changing those out periodically. The same thing would be true with your roller covers. If you're doing large scale projects, you'll start to get activated material on your roller cover. And if you're doing really big projects, you need to periodically change out your roller covers to ensure that you're not having hardening or curing material on those roller covers that could potentially cause issues with defects on the floor and so forth. So again, Mike's gone ahead and he's evenly applied that material. Now he's going to come back after he's applied, and he's going to go ahead and take a roller cover. Again, high quality, non-shedding, epoxy-rated roller cover. And you can see on this, he's going to go ahead and nice crosshatch V roll pattern and ensure even coverage. Again, we've got great working times, but be mindful if we have elevated temperatures or if maybe you don't have adequate staff and you're a little, you know, shorthanded, that you are mindful of the working times and pot lives of these products, or if you're in elevated temperatures, that's going to be a crucial factor. So a nice application here. Now, it's always great to thin to win in multiple coats to ensure even applications. If you have a skilled team, you can sometimes get away with a single coat finish. But as we know in our industry, most of the time it requires two coats to ensure even, consistent finish across the board. So that is our liquid granite and liquid terrazzo system. Again, really, really versatile for garage installations, anywhere where they're looking for this type of thinner build, epoxy chip finish aesthetic. Again, you have the option to have UV stable finishes by utilizing the polyaspartic line. You also saw here the EC15 MVB. That EC15 MVB, we showed in the liquid granite, liquid terrazzo, but you could utilize that in any of our epoxy systems, whether that be our liquid dazzle that we're gonna show you, our metallic epoxy. That could be our double broadcast Dubro system. That could be our flex epoxy or epoxy mortar. Anywhere, again, where you have that need, or where there is the requirement for a moisture vapor barrier.